bug in ear coaching is real-time coaching. So the research behind coaching is pretty significant. Coaching along the way helps with implementation and fidelity of implementation of interventions and teaching behaviors. So what bug in ear does is bug in ear is actually real-time coaching. So you can see here on the left side, the young lady with the headset on is the coach, and she is connected to the classroom where you see the gentleman and the students through some video conferencing platform like Zoom, Skype. She has the headset on. She is listening to the classroom. She is watching the video of the classroom. The teacher in the classroom has that small Bluetooth headset that has both a microphone and a speaker. The coach is communicating with the teacher in real time. So when the coach sees something to either give feedback or correction on, she or he will say that. The teacher will hear it immediately and be able to change behavior or smile broadly because they're getting positive praise, or be able to change what's happening in that classroom right at that moment, as opposed to reflecting on it at a later time. So that's really what this bug in ear coaching is. It's actually coaching in real time. The coach communicates with the teacher while they're teaching, and that allows behavior to change immediately.
The question is, how have we used bug in ear? We've used it in a variety of ways. We have used it with PhD students. At George Mason University, we have our PhD students in their program typically teach our undergraduate licensure classes. Sometimes they come in with experience, and then other times they're really novice at being a teacher educator. So their comfort level is not as good as we would like it to be. So we've supported them through bug in ear coaching. So while they're teaching in real time to their group of teacher candidates, we would connect remotely from our offices or from home, and we would coach them while they were delivering classes in real time. We have also used it with pre-service special education teachers in a limited sense. And when I share lessons learned, I'll kind of talk through why that was more limited.
We've also used it with in-service special education teachers. And for us at Mason, we have a very large cohort program where individuals who are on a provisional license are hired by some of the large school divisions around us. They take coursework through Mason. And then when they get to their internship or when they're in their field placements, we did bug in ear coaching with them, some of them just in their internship. And others, we actually did a pilot where we started with them in their first semester when they're standing in front of students for the first time, coaching them as they went through the program and in their first 2 years of teaching experience. We also did a project with one of our local divisions where they had instructional coaches dedicated to helping teachers implement new systematic reading programs. And so we trained their instructional reading coaches, which they called SIFARs. We trained them to use bug in ear to work with their teachers who they were coaching in the reading programs. So that was a lot of fun and a different way to sort of build capacity because we were training the trainers essentially and then using bug in ear in that capacity.
Our next section of this is to share what we've learned. So for the teacher candidates who's receiving the coaching, the key lesson that we learned is one size does not fit all, meaning that when we first became used to the technology, we were eager to use this with everybody. And so when we did, we sort of had to put the brakes on. There are some prerequisite skills that you would want your teacher candidates to know and be able to do before implementing or employing this practice, bug in ear. If teacher candidates cannot identify a learning objective or they aren't matching the needs of the learners with the teaching objective, they're not going to be ready to hear what you're saying and adjust their instruction in real time. There's a readiness, if you will, of specific skills that teacher candidates will likely need before there's bug in ear. So the second top key lesson that we learned is to scaffold. We learned to do this in two ways. We think it's best in a teacher prep program if you scaffold the practice of bug in ear over time, like the length of a teacher prep program, and then also by intensity. Typically, clinical experience comes culminating at the end of a teacher prep program. When that happens, there's a lot on a teacher candidate's plate. And in addition, when we're using bug in ear, they have to become accustomed to the technology the process and the nuances that come with bug in ear. And so that can be a lot for a teacher candidate who's being observed and receiving feedback. So one of the lessons that we've learned is that if you have an opportunity to use this in a preparation program, introduce the elements of bug in ear over the span of their program. So one example of that was effective in our program. It was received positively by a cohort of students whose internship was divided into three separate semesters. And in each of those semesters, they became more accustomed to the practice of bug in ear. Another way that we did it was in their methods classes, giving them an opportunity to do like a micro teaching assignment and practice using bug in ear in sort of an informal setting. The second part of that is with the intensity of bug in ear. So when we would connect with the interns, we learned that providing them with positive feedback and cues to adjust their instruction was cognitively too much. The cognitive demand was too big a load. So a way to scaffold it is to first just have them practice putting that in their ear and teaching at the same time, because that's going to be a new feeling. The coach doesn't say anything. And then the next time you connect, maybe the coach just says some positive feedback occasionally, intermittently, while the teacher is teaching. And then the next time you connect, you can provide not only positive feedback, but also performance-based feedback. So scaffolding it by intensity as well is a lesson that we learned over time. So our third key lesson for the teacher candidate is to really target the skills. So during a bug in ear coaching session, prior to that, the coach and the teacher candidate have collaboratively sat down and determined a targeted skill. So that's based on need and it's based on priority to make it manageable for the teacher candidate and for the coach. So targeted skills might be pacing, where you're saying to the intern, I'm going to say move on, okay? It could be provided more examples, provide more OTR. So these types of skills are targeted skills or examples of targeted skills. Going back to the example I shared earlier, where we separated the internship into three big chunks, we would coach during the first semester of that chunk just on targeting explicit instruction. So aspects of explicit instruction was the focus area. In the second semester, we targeted behavior management. A lot of the targeted skills was increase that use of positive praise, right? And then by the time we had the third semester, we were able to really individualize the skills that we were going to focus on during the coaching. So those are the top key lessons that we learned for the teacher candidate.
One of the things we found as we started to dig into doing this bug in ear coaching is everybody was talking about the teacher candidate and nobody was talking about, well, gosh, what do you do as a coach? So we really did some work in terms of what is it that the coach does and what is the progression or the development of a coach? Because, you know, you can't go from 0 to 60 as a coach, just like the teacher candidate can't absorb everything at once. There's an article here where we did a case study about one of our e-coaches, one of our colleagues who we mentored into this coaching experience. But we do have a couple of lessons learned for the coaches as well. The first lesson we learned is you really need to practice before you sort of jump into a live situation with a teacher. One of the things we did for practice was we coached each other in our classes. You know, you don't have things going on necessarily as quickly in teacher prep classes as you do in the K-12 classroom. So we took some deep breaths and we coached each other. The other thing we did, and we did this a lot with training the trainers, was we used video. So we'd have classroom video and we'd all be sitting around the table and we'd say, okay, our target behavior is this. We're going to coach on that. So let's watch the video. And wherever you see something happening that you would want to coach, just say it out loud. And we did that for a while until we got to the point where we could anticipate what was going to happen. And then we observed each other coaching and tried to figure out where do we jump in? How do we jump in? Because there really is a rhythm that you have to develop with your teacher candidates in terms of they need to know that every once in a while they got to stop talking so they can hear you actually say something. So there has to be a little bit of a cadence in how they're teaching so that you can say things in their ears and then they can process it. The other thing we had to come to realize was there are going to be times where a coachable moment passes you by, right? So something happens and you're halfway into it and then the instance is gone. And you're just going to have to deal with that and try to get better through practice. You have to really understand that you're not going to get every single moment of coachable time, but you'll get enough with practice that it'll be really meaningful for the teacher candidate. We decided that the way we wanted to do coaching was short prompts and cues for teacher behavior. We did not want to narrate what was happening in the classroom and then give explanations or give long instructions. We decided we wanted to be quiet and then either give positive reinforcement or we give a prompt or a cue for a targeted behavior. And one of the things we did ahead of time with the teacher candidates is when we're sitting down and doing the goal setting, we're coming up with words. One of the things we targeted with a lot of our students was giving specific praise or giving specific feedback to students or giving them an opportunity to respond. So we negotiated prompts that would work and that they may have been the same behaviors, but we may have had different cues with each one of our teacher candidates. For example, give feedback, watch the front, ask a question, turn that into a question, scan, move. They knew we had already negotiated what that meant. So when I say move, what action do you take? You don't have to say anything, but I want you to move to a different part of the room. If I give you positive praise, you don't have to do anything. You don't have to acknowledge. You don't have to say anything back to me. You smile, maybe think about it and move on. If I'm quiet, it just means I'm watching. Making all actions explicit. So if I say this as a coach, I want you to do that, the statement and then the reaction. And there were times where we were having a long dialogue between, and it looked like the teacher was talking to themselves in front of the class because they were talking into the headset. So we had to negotiate how things were being done and make sure that all of our actions were explicit. Those were the big lessons that we learned. We saw levels of change in all of our student teachers, all of our interns. We saw differences in what we were coaching on. One example that was really significant to us was particularly with the reading specialists who were newly trained in multisensory systematic instruction of reading. And some of them would mispronounce vowel sounds. We could instantaneously change that so that their students weren't practicing an incorrect vowel sound. So we could change it immediately. The teacher could practice the right pronunciation. The students could practice the right pronunciation, and we didn't have to come back to it at another time. Feasibility, right now, it's pretty feasible because a $25 at maximum Bluetooth headset is really what you need because everybody else has Zoom and all of these other things available to them. And teachers were really reflecting because once you had the interaction be in the teaching situation, then you could have reflective commentary at the end and the teacher was really with you as opposed to thinking back over the broad section of an observation.